minute.
Okay. All right, so last week what we talked about on Thursday was the library of functions. And so you have specific functions that you should be able to just look at, and you'll see these in the first couple of homework problems, and identify, like the parabola, the absolute value function, the square root function, the reciprocal function. If you haven't gotten to that yet, you need to go back and do it, because what we're doing today is we're going to transform those graphs, which means we're going to be moving them around the plane, reflecting them, stretching them. And anyone who's gone on into trig, this is what I'm getting ready to teach in trig, is we're taking basic graphs and we're learning how to do these sorts of different shifts. So it's really important for that. So what I'm going to do, because the square root function does not contain any sort of symmetry, it's easiest with that one to see what happens. But the things we're doing would be true about any of the graphs, or any other graphs for that matter. All right, so we're going to start with the square root function. And just so that everybody understands the square root function, I want to do a few points. First of all, can you? It's graphed here in red. Can you guys tell what the domain is? Where does
it start?
Yes. Okay. 0 to positive infinity. It does include 0. The range is the same thing, right? Can everybody see that? Okay. So now, algebraically, I mean, when you're looking at a graph, you can see what the domain is. But algebraically, remember that the radicand, which is just the expression under the even function, has to be greater than or equal to 0. You can't plug in negative numbers because we don't have any way to represent them here. Okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pick a few values. So we'll start at 0, and we're going to plug them in just to get an idea of the points that you see plotted. So if I plug in 0 for x, to get the y, I take the square root of 0, which is 0. So that's this point right here. If I plug in 1 for x, I get 1. So let's plot that point. It's the point 1, 1. And if I plug in 4 for x, the square root of 4 is 2. Yeah. Now, of course, there's other values in between, but those three are ones that you could do without a calculator. So does everybody feel like they understand the graph of the square root function?
Is that supposed to be on 2 or 4?
4 for x, okay. And 2 for y, because the square root of 4 is 2. Okay, so what we're going to graph right near or on the same coordinate axis is a change to that graph. So we're going to graph, this is our original function, f of x equals the square root of x. We're going to graph f of x add 2. So let's see how to read that. Remember, when you look at function notation, that's talking about an output. So this is saying the output for this function, but then add 2 to that. Does everybody understand the symbols and what they're telling you? Okay, so think about that. We can plot physical points and see what's happening, but just think about what that would do. Your output is your y values, right? So if we're taking every y value, that's what f of x is, right? And we're adding 2, what's going to happen to the original graph?
It's going to change.
Yeah, it's going to change in what way?
By adding two.
It's, can somebody explain to me, like, if I'm trying to follow your directions, what would I have to do, maybe with those three points that I've graphed?
Go up two,
right? It's taking every y, and it's taking every y, you see how it says that? Mm-hmm. And it's adding 2. And so what that looks like is this point moves to here. Moves straight up 2. This point moves up to here. And this point moves up to here. And so what we just graphed was the original function. This is f of x. We graphed f of x add 2. With the rule, what is f of x plus 2? It's square root of x and then add 2. You see the order that you're supposed to go according to the symbols. So if you were going to make a table of values, let's do those same 3. And I'm only using those because they're small integers and we know what their square roots are. That's why I'm using those particular values. But if we take the square root of the x value and then add 2, let's see what happens. We get square root of 0 plus 2. That's going to be 0 plus 2, which is 2. If we take square root of 1, add 2, that's 1 plus 2. So that one moved to 3, which I just did that by counting, by following the symbols and counting. I don't really want you to have to use points, but while we're learning it, I think it might be helpful to see what the points are and what's happening to them. Okay, and square root of 4, add 2. That would be 2 plus 2 gives me 4. And see, that's where I moved this point to. It's now 4, 4. So you can physically see the calculations that are changing all the y's by 2. Okay, so what we observed is that when we had the plus 2, it shifted f of x up 2 units. That's what it did. It took every single point and just moved it straight up. So let's look at another kind of change. And what you're going to see on every page is that original function, because we're going to see what happens to that original function. Where does it go with the different changes? So your original function is always the square root of x in these examples. So what happens if we add 2 to x before we take the square root? Here's what that rule would look like. Now, this one's a little bit trickier. Let's think about the domain, first of all. Remember algebraically how you get the domain is you take the radicand, the expression under the even root, and you solve an inequality, because this is saying x plus 2 has to come out greater than 0 or it could be equal to 0. And so my domain starts at negative 2, and then it extends to the right. That's what you guys did in domain, in the domain homework.
Why does it start at negative 2?
Because, you know, I've got to isolate the x, right? I want to know what x is.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay. So x can be as small as negative 2, but that's it. That's as small as it can be. So what I want to do then is let's start at negative 2. And we'll kind of follow what goes along, and I think you guys will see. So if I plug in negative 2 for x, here's what I'm going to do. I've got negative 2 plus 2, right? I'm adding to the x first before taking the square root. And so that would be the square root of 0, which is 0. So let's write the point over here.
Camera a little bit.
Okay, so let's write the point that we just found. It's the x value negative 2 is paired with y value 0. So we'll go ahead and plot that. So give me another integer to try. Okay, good. Negative 1. She's kind of following my pattern of just moving up by 1, right? So we get negative 1 plus 2, which is the square root of 1, which is 1. So That's where we get that same y that I got for the second point that I plotted. But the x I needed was negative 1 to give me the y, you know, that goes with that point. And so let's plot that one. That would be at negative 1, positive 1. So what would be the next integer you think I'm going to plug in?
Negative
0.
You want to do 0? Okay, now if I do, we can do 0, but then we've got to use our calculator, right? Because we have 0 plus 2, square root of 2, I don't know exactly what that is. So 2, they're saying 2, okay. Let's plug in 2 for x. See, they're seeing what made it come out to a nice integer that's a perfect square. Square root of 4 is 2, and so that point is the point 2, 2. So what I want y'all to do is observe and compare what happened when we added 2 to the x before it was a square root. What did that do to the original graph? What, where did it shift to? What would you say?
Left.
It shifted left by 2. So look at what you want to observe. We added 2 to x. It kind of did the opposite of what we thought it would do, didn't it? I mean, because in the last problem, what we did was we really were adding 2 to the y. You see the difference? Because here you were taking square root first and then adding 2. With this one, you're adding 2 to the x and then doing the square root. So when we added 2 to the y, it did exactly what we expected. It shifted up, because this is positive, by 2. But when we added 2 to the x, it did kind of the opposite of what we might think intuitively. It seems like that should shift it right, but it didn't. It shifted it to the left, too. So if we add 2 to your x, that shifts the graph left by 2. Now, I do have a little trick for this one, and I think it's important that you remember this, and I'll tell you when we get to reflections why it's important. So here's my little trick. If you're adding or subtracting to your x, set the expression that has the x equal to 0 and solve it, and it'll show you what happens. That's showing me it's actually a shift left of 2 instead of a right 2. Sure. My trick, and I'll explain to you in a little while why you want this, because you might be thinking, okay, if I subtract 2, that would shift right. Mm-hmm. If I add 2, that would shift left. And you'd be correct. But in a little while, we're going to do reflections. That throws us all off. So I think this is a better way to do it, is to take your x expression, which was an x plus 2, set it equal to 0, solve it for x, and it'll show you what the direction is. Okay? That'll work for everything. That'll work when we also have a see, what we're going to come into in a little bit is a negative in front of the x. And that turns everything around. Yeah.
How come the last one shifted up and this one went to the left?
Well, the reason for that, if you want to know, is kind of what I said here. So let me add a page. And I think his question is a really, really good one. And I think it's worth taking a look at it, but I don't want anybody to get confused by it either. So let me just show you what happened. Okay, now originally, remember, we had for y equals the square root of x, the values that I chose for x were 0, 1, and 4. I was just trying to pick things that were easy to take the square root for. We took the square root, and we got square root 0, square root 1, square root 4. Okay? Now, what's happening when you look at the square root of x plus 2 the numbers that you guys kind of naturally came up with, some students sitting here did, is they came up with the ones that gave those same whys, right? Not that we have to, but that just kind of shows you why this thing is moving to the left. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set this x plus 2 equal to these numbers, and we're going to solve and see what happens. So if I set x plus 2 equals 0, I get x equals negative 2, right? And remember, that was the first thing people told me to plug in. So look what happens. If we plug in negative 2, we got negative 2 plus 2, which is 0. So that gave me that point that was at the same level, okay? If I set x plus 2 equal to 1, solve it for me. So you're going to subtract 2, right? And you get negative 1. And that was what she picked as a good point to try. So, see, that gave me the 1. And then if I set x plus 2 equal to 4 and solve, I get the x equals 2. So do you see why it's making the shift? It's taking those points that are at that same level of y, but we're figuring out what x is giving us that same y value. That one came, that was 2, and so we had the 2 plus 2, which is what gave us the 4. So that's why. That's also why my trick works, okay, because we start with that first one and just see what's happening. Okay, so let's look at the next one. We're going to figure out the graph of f of x minus 2. Now, we can plug in numbers, but I want y'all, based on what we just figured out, to tell me if you think you know already what's going to happen. It's going to do what?
Shift right.
Shift right, too. Okay? Because you're doing something to x first. And the trick that I gave you is that. So that means that those three points that I plotted that were the easiest to plot and get a decent graph, those are all going to shift straight to the right. That's called shifting horizontally. This is a vertical shift. This is a horizontal shift. Okay? But this one shifts to 2. This one shifts to 3. X equals 3. And the one that's at 4, 2, that's going to shift over here to 6. That point, or that graph, shifted to the right, too. So the points that you could look at there are 2, 3, and 6. These are just comparing to the 3 that we graphed on the original function. And you can see what's happening. 2 minus 2 is the one that gives me the 0. 3 minus 2 is the one that gives me the square root of 1. And 6 minus 2 is the one that gives me the square root of 4, which is 2. Okay? And remember, it's not that I'm going to want you to plot these individual points, but I just want everybody to be able to look back and go, why did that shift to the right or why did that shift to the left? And so you can see the numbers for it to make more sense to you. Now, what you want to get good at, though, after you wrap your minds around the concepts, after you kind of see what's going on, is you want to be able to go, okay, that's a change to x. So what is that change to x? If I take x and subtract 2, that's going to shift the original graph to the right, 2.
So is it every time using negative?
If it's just x, yes. But we're going to throw in reflections in a minute, and that throws everything backwards, okay? And be careful, because if you guys go get help from somebody else, they might not be thinking carefully about reflections in addition to the subtractions and additions. And they might say what you just said. Every time I subtract from x, I move to the right. Every time I add to x, I move to the left. Yes, if it's just x. But if it's negative x, it's going to do the opposite of that. Okay. All right, so, and I'm going to have a little summary sheet for you in just a minute. You'll see it in your notes. Let's look at what happens. Oh, let me point something else out. Okay, so the left-right shifts. Every single point moves, right? If you're going up or down, every single point is going to move that many units. So now we're going to look at something a little different. Those were additions and subtractions. What happens?
We divide and multiply?
Yes. What happens when you divide or multiply? So you need to think about this for a second. Here's another thing to think about. Anytime you see f of x, remember that is y. So I'm not doing anything to x first this time. I'm taking 2 times the y value each time. So if we multiply every y value by 2, what does that do? Let's try to do it without points.
Double it.
Yes, it's going to double it. Okay, it's going to double every y value, right? So let's try to do it without plugging in numbers, but we can plug in numbers also for those who would like to kind of see why what happens happens. So what's the y value right here?
Zero.
What's 2 times 0?
2
times 0?
Zero.
So that one doesn't move. You know, if it's an addition, that would have moved. If it was a subtraction, it would have moved. But when it's a multiplication by 0, it's just still 0. So that one did not change. Okay, what's the y value at this point?
1.
What's 2 times 1?
2.
2. So that would go here, right?
Mm-hmm.
2 times 1. Okay, what's the y value here?
2.
2. And so 2 times 2 is 4. And we are going to have to be careful. We're going to do some other kinds of graphs in a little while. And if we have a negative, we got to keep track of that, you know, because if it's negative 1 times 2, that's going to be negative 2. All right, now if you were looking at specific points, and again, I'm picking those 3 that are so easy because of the square roots that are easy. We're taking 2 times the square root of this x value. So 2 times square root 0, 2 times 0. See, that's why that one stayed at 0, 0. The second one was 2 times the square root of 1. So that's 2 times 1. Remember, you guys told me that doubled. Okay, the 1 doubled, so we were at a y value 2. Notice I was at the same, for the same x, I was at twice the y. And then when we had 4, that's 2 times square root of 4, which is 2 times 2. And what you told me, when we were at x equals 4, the y is 2. If you want to write the point I was looking at there was 4, 2. So the y got doubled, so it went up here. Okay? That is what's called a vertical stretch. It's pulling this thing up. It's like if you double my height, you're stretching me. Okay, I'm going to get taller. Okay, so that's a stretch. So, Did I go too fast on that one? Did I get what they needed? All right. So, what do you think happens? And I hope I know you said division. Okay, that's the same kind of thing. What is that going to do? If I take half of
it? Shrinks?
Yeah, it shrinks it. It's a vertical shrink. How can we tell that the 1 half times f of x is a shrink while the 2 times f of x is a stretch? Because you're taking half of it. What do you think the number that makes the change would be?
2?
1.
Okay, 1. Yeah, 1, because if we're bigger than 1 and we multiply, then we're going to increase the y values, right? So if this is, this was mentioned, division. Okay, f of x over 2 is the same thing as 1 half times x. That would be the same thing. That's like dividing every y value by 2, or multiplying by a half, same thing. So what happens here? This was at 0, 0.
Stays.
days. Okay, this one had a Y value of 1. So it'd be at half, right? This Y value was 2. Remember, that's the 0.42. So what happens? Yep, it goes to 1. We're taking 1 half of 2. That gives us 1. And so that one is shrinking. Okay? Now, to see the actual points, because sometimes people would rather not see the geometry, they'd rather see the points. Let's just do this real quick. So we're taking 1 half the square root of x. So that's 1 half square root of 0. 1 half of 0 is 0. 1 half the square root of 1 is 1 half times 1. See, that's where we plotted that one, at 1, 1 half. And then 1 half the square root of 4 is 1 half of 2, which was 1. That's what we wrote there. Now, it's okay while you're learning this to write out the points so you can understand it and think about it, but you do want to get good at being able to just do what a lot of students sitting here were able to do, where they just realize, okay, 0 times 1 half is still 0, so that one didn't move. That one's going to be half. This is going to be half.
Would you say okay. To do the table to check our work to make sure we did?
Sure, you can do that. Yeah, absolutely. The main thing is first understand it, understand what these shifts are doing, but then be able to look and say, okay, to shift up, I need to add. To shift left, I need to add. And so on. Okay? All right, so one other change. By the way, so this was I should have written this one. This is a vertical shrink. We are not going, in this class, we're not going to do horizontal stretches and shrinks. That is something you do in trigonometry. But if you do a good job in here on this topic, then you'll be able to extend it to one more thing in geometry, which will be those kinds of things. Yeah.
Why?
Why what?
Why don't we go into horizontal?
I think it's because this is enough for people. Just wait, because we're gonna do a lot of different kinds of things. But I mean, if you understand the vertical shrink and stretch. Then you're going to understand, if you go to trig, you're going to understand that what happens to x is the opposite of what you think with those as well, just like it is with the additions and subtractions. Okay.
Is that why in geometry they taught us stretch and shrink?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Makes sense.
Compression and what's the other word?
I forgot. It was eighth grade.
Okay. So you do remember it?
No, I don't.
Oh, you don't? Okay.
Geometry?
That's okay. All right, so now we're going to graph the opposite of f of x. Now, again, what you want to think about here is whenever you see f of x, that's the y. So we're negating y. We're not negating x. Why don't we do this one a little bit differently? We could do our points, but let's write down what these three points are and just think about things. So remember, these are the ones that I graphed on the original y equals square root of x. That's our original function. That's our original f of x. Okay? So if we're going to graph the opposite of that function, what does that mean? It means we're taking the opposite of every y. Does everybody see it that way with the symbols? Because in a minute, we're going to put the negative on the inside and talk about that. Okay? If the negative's on the outside, remember, if you see f of x, that is the same thing as y. And so you can read that as it's the opposite of your y. Okay? Now think about y. Here's your y-axis. All of these have positive y values. So they're all going to be negative y values. It's not changing the x's, it's changing the y's. So what's the opposite of zero?
Zero.
So that one stays. What's the opposite of 1?
Negative 1.
So that one comes down here. You see what happens? It reflects across which axis?
Yes.
So if we put the negative on the outside, it reflects your function across the x-axis. Why? Because above the x-axis, y is positive. Below the x-axis, the y is negative. Okay? So where's the point 4, 2 going to reflect to?
Negative 2.
It's just the y's that are the opposite. That last point was 4, negative 2. We're negating y. Okay, so now let's think about the domain if we put the negative on the input value, the x value. So we're going to graph f of the opposite of x. First, I want you to look at the domain. Let's look at it algebraically. Remember, algebraically, your x expression, remember this would mean the square root of the opposite of x. Now some people might look at that and say, oh, you can't do that, because they're seeing square root of a negative. Am I right?
Yeah.
Did anybody think that? Okay. Let's look at the algebra for finding the domain. How do I solve this? This is saying that the opposite of x has to be greater than 0. Well, let's solve it, though. Let's solve it for x first. What do I do to solve that for
change
x?
Change the sign.
Okay, change the sign and also divide by 1, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or negative 1, rather. Look at that. Oh, if we pick x values below 0 or equal to 0, we're going to be okay. Let's physically do this so you guys can see what's going on. So I'm going to pick 0, negative 1, and negative 4. And we're going to take the square root of the opposite of the x value. Isn't that what that says?
Mm-hmm.
Square root of the opposite of x. So the opposite of 0 is
0.
So we do get the point 0, 0. Okay, now let's replace x with negative 1, but notice what this says is take the opposite of that. So see how it becomes a positive?
Yeah.
Opposite of a negative is a positive. So that's 1. So what's that point? It's the point negative 1, 1. Negative 1, 1 is right here. What's the reflection this time? It's across the y. Going to be across the y-axis. Okay, let's do one more. The opposite of negative 4 is 4. So we're going to get 2. And so the point, or the x value negative 4 produces a value. It is in the domain. And that's here. So look, it reflected across the y-axis because these positive x's, now we have to use their opposites, which are on the other side of the y-axis. Am I giving you all time enough to let this sink in? Okay, so let's just review. If we have f of x if we have f of x, remember that's y, and we add 2, that shifted the entire graph up by 2, because up is a y direction, right? This is changing y by 2. What if this had been minus 2? Shifted all down by 2, right? And there's nothing special about the 2. That's just what I chose. If I add 2 to the x, that shifted everything left by 2. Uh-huh. And remember, it's you're doing something to the x before the y. Okay, and so we also showed the right shift. 2 on the outside is a vertical stretch. If this is a number bigger than 1, it's going to stretch your graph. But any point that's on the x-axis is going to stay put. It's going to stay on the ground. So think of stretching or shrinking a person. Okay, their feet are going to stay on the ground, right? Same thing with the graph. Its feet are going to stay on the ground, the x-axis. That's not going to change. All right, but the rest of the points will change. And if it's below 1, it's going to shrink. If you put a negative on the outside, that's negating, bless you, that's negating y, but here are positive y's, here are negative y's. So it reflects across the x-axis. And then if you put the negative on the inside, that's negating x. So any positive y's would now have to be negative y's. And we only looked at one where the domain originally was positive numbers. You'll have graphs where you've got points on both sides. Okay, let's see. I must have one that's got several shifts. Yes. So, we're going to figure this thing out, right? Graph, the opposite of f of x minus 1 plus 3. We're doing 3 different changes on this one. And what we're going to do on this one is we're just going to follow the points. So I'm going to have you in order, think of order of operations here. Think about what happens to each point. So we're going to write that down. You would always work inside parentheses first. So this is what would happen first. What does that tell me to do? Okay. Shift right by 1. Right? Okay. Second thing would be the negative on the outside. Where does that reflection go? What's that? Yes. Reflect across the x-axis. Okay, and then the third change is over here. And that's for adding 3.
Up 3,
yes. Shift up 3. So let's take a point and let's do those 3 things so that people can follow the 3 different changes to a point. So we're going to start with the 0, 0. So we're going to do one thing at a time. If I shift 0, 0, right 1, then now I am at 1, 0, right? I'd be here. Mm-hmm. Okay? So I did the first thing to that point. Okay, now the second point is to reflect across the x-axis. But if you're on the x-axis, what do? You just stay. Okay? It's on the x-axis. So it stays. We can do this with another point, too. So we're still there. We're still at 1, 0. Now, what about shifting up by 3?
Just score 3 points.
Okay, what is it that changes by 3? The y. So that would be 0 plus 3, right? Because it's the y, okay, that's shifting up by 3. So that's going to come to 1, 3. So this point got shifted right. The reflection didn't affect it, and then it got shifted up. Let's do the second point together, and then I'm going to let you practice and do the third one on your own. Okay, so let's start with the point 1, 1. So we're going to look at 1, 1. Shift it right by 1. Where is it now? Okay, it's at 2-1. It's at 2-1, right? Okay, now reflected across the x-axis, where is it going to be? 2, negative 1. Goes across the x-axis. 2, negative 1. So now you're here. And now you're going to shift it up by 3. So you take your y and you're shifting up by 3. So it goes to 2, 2. So follow again. It started here. It shifted right. It got reflected. And now it's going up 1, 2, 3. And I don't want all these points on here. Let me make sure I got my 0, 0 in the right place. It shifted right. It reflected. And then it shifted up. Yeah. So that's the starting point. Okay, so you guys do that, those three things, do those to the point 4-2. Take 4-2 and do those three shifts. Shift it right, reflect it across the x-axis, and then move it up. Much information on here. Where did you guys land?
5-1. Mm-hmm. Over.
Okay, so you're at 5. Three, where one. Are you now?
5-1.
That's 2.
5-1.
Oh, sounds like we're getting some different answers. So let's follow it together. Okay, we shifted 1 over, right? Mm-hmm. That would put you at 5-2. Everybody was there?
Yeah.
Then you reflect. So you're down here. And then you move up. 1, 2, 3. So the people who were saying, my fingers are thin. The people that were saying 5-1 got it correct. All right, so I actually did, I'm only going to do one of these, but there's another video that I did that's in your module. I wrote you about it today. It's the same kind of problem, okay? Because I usually will have students messaging me on this problem. You'll see a parabola, and they're going to ask you to come up with the formula. So we're kind of doing the opposite thing now. What we're going to do is we're going to look and see what the changes to y equals x squared have been to write the formula for this new parabola, okay? So this is where, if you didn't look at your library of functions yet, let me just get this one quiet. This is referring to one of those. This is the parabola, which is the y equals x squared. Notice your library of functions are all one operation functions. You either take a square root, you square something, you reciprocal. They were all just one thing that you did to the x. Okay, so what you want to do is you want to see where things shifted to. First of all, do you see a reflection? Do you think? Did it flip upside down? A reflection across the y-axis with a parabola doesn't really do anything, right? If I flip all these points across the y-axis, they're over here. And if I flip all these points across the y-axis, they're over there. So that kind of reflection has no bearing on a parabola. So the only kind of reflection I'm going to be talking about is across the x-axis. So are we seeing it turn upside down?
No.
What do y'all say? No, it didn't turn upside down. Remember, you probably in 1033 had to do, like, you knew that opens downward. Okay, well, now you understand a little bit more why. That's a reflection. It reflects it down. Okay, so we don't have a reflection. But we do see, I would look at the vertex, and I would think in terms of right-left shift, and then an up-down shift. Okay? So follow this vertex. Where did it shift to if you're going right or left? Did it go right or did it go left?
Left.
Okay, left side direction.
No, no.
Okay. It went right, didn't it? And can, you guys may, it's in your notes, so you have to look down at your notes, but that's at 3.5. Okay, so what does that look like? Well, that's a change to X. If it's a right shift, I should do minus or plus. Yes, minus. You see how that's a right shift? Okay? Now, it also did something else. Okay, so the vertex moved here, and then where did it go?
Down.
Down by 6.25. That's a change in the Y. So there you go. There's an equation for that parabola. Now, you might be wondering about stretches. We're not going to be that mean to you. Okay? For stretches, you would have to do some other algebra to figure those out. That would be harder. Okay, so it'll only be, on this problem, it'll only, you could have a reflection, which means you would put a negative out here if it flips down. But you'll only see right or left shift and up or down on that one. And you're coming up with the formula. Okay, now I wanted to point out to you, especially those that are going into pre-calc algebra or pre-calc trig, you might want to save this page because there's all your general things that we just went over. It's showing you if you add a number, what that does. If you add a number to x, if you multiply the f of x by something and it distinguishes between if it's greater than 1 or less than 1. So this is just a summary page for you of all of that. And if you find a summary page you like better, let me know about it. If you like the way it's written better, and I might, you know, change what it says in the notes. Okay, so these can all be combined, and so I just gave an example of that. F of x plus 4 and then add 2 would mean a left shift of 4 and an up shift of 2. Okay, so Here's a question for y'all to think about. Think about the square root function. Y equals square root of x. Reflecting that through the origin would mean it would go over here. Because think about, you know, we talked about symmetry, so that's helpful here. Okay? So that would be what reflecting the origin means. So I want you to write down what you think the formula is for that function. If this is the square root function, and this is the square root function reflected through the origin, write down what you think that formula would be. What'd you guys say?
Y equals negative.
Negative?
Square root x.
You think square root of x? Okay, I see somebody shaking their head.
Should be x equals square root of y?
What is your guess?
X equals square root of y.
No, it's still going to be y.
Okay.
Yeah, it would still be y. Anybody else? Get something different? Let's check this one. What does that say to do? That says to reflect your original y, right? Because it's on the outside of the square root. So that means that would be here. So what else does he need?
Negative.
Yes, we've got to negate both of them, don't we? We've got to negate both of them because we not only want to reflect this across the x-axis, we also then want to reflect it across the y-axis. So that's the formula for reflecting that function through the origin. You have to negate both x and y. That's correct. Now, how many people have come across math problems like this? When you first looked at them, you went, what? That doesn't make any sense at all. But then when you got into it, you said, oh, that's just easy. Have you had some problems like that before?
Yeah.
Okay, if you haven't, you're about to have one. Okay, I promise you, these problems are not hard, especially if you understood what we've been talking about before now. All right? It's just understanding what they're asking. So, this is what they're saying here. We have a function. We do not know what this function is. You with me? But we know one thing about it. It contains that point, the point 1, negative 18. Now, I do think it would be helpful to just draw that point. So, just rough sketch. Okay, so 1, negative 18, I'm just going to draw it like that. Because that would be a positive x and a negative y. So it's somewhere down there in the fourth quadrant. So we don't know anything else about this function. That's all we know about it. So is everybody with me so far?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is what you're answering. A point on the graph of a different function, okay, g of x. This one came from f of x. Where g of x is equivalent to the opposite of f of x is what? Well, we have one point to go by. So how would g of x be formed? If it's the opposite of f of x, what does that mean? What does that mean? What gets negated?
The y
gets negated, okay? That negates y. It flips your point across the x-axis. So what they're asking you for is the one point that you can tell them is on that function. So you have to use the one point you know was on the original function. Do you understand what they're asking?
Yes.
Okay, so where does that go? If it gets reflected across the x-axis, where would it go?
Positive 18.
Yes, it'd be 1, positive 18. So you're kind of just practicing what these changes are with one point. That's what you're doing here. Okay? All right, what's the next thing asking you to do? A point on the graph of y equals g of x, where g of x is equal. Came from taking f of x minus 8, it's going down 8. So we need to subtract 8 from the negative 18, right? This is down 8. Down is a y direction. And so we're going to take negative 18 minus 8, just move it down. So, yeah, so that point. Now, that, remember, the x didn't change. So there's your answer. 1, negative 26. Okay, so what about the next one? What are you supposed to do to get your change there? 1/3 of what? The y. Yes, good, because f of x, remember, is the same thing as y. What's the original y? Okay, so 1/3 of negative 18 is negative 6. There's no change to the x, so that's 1 negative 6 is the only point we know on that new graph. You guys getting the hang of it?
Yeah.
Okay, what about negative x if we negate the x first? Okay, that takes the point across the y-axis, okay? So that would be negative 1, negative 18. Let me let everybody do the next one. What'd y'all get? The 1 and
negative 90.
Is that right? That seems right. Everybody getting that one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. sometimes I take an answer from one person and don't check it.
It's maybe 90.
It is 90. Good. I just like to verify. Yes.
So that's just negative or 5 times y.
Yes, that's what that says, right? Because f of x is the same thing as y. So that's where he got that from. 5 times negative 18 is negative 90. All right, now you have to be a little more careful with this one, right? Because you're, yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, but when it says g of x, so it's talking about...
g of x is the new function, yes. And so all we would know on g of x is this one point.
Okay.
That's what I think is a little confusing.
So that's just the name of the new...
Right, that's right. That's the name of the new function. Okay, now what does this say to do?
To add 12 to
x. It's not saying to add 12 to x.
Subtract 12.
Subtract 12. There's your little tricky thing, remember? Okay, if you want to be really careful, remember, this is it's moving it left.
Yeah.
So you could say, what happens to the 1 if I change it to x plus 12 and solve? Remember how I told you to set that equal to 0?
Okay.
You can set it equal to any x value. Okay, and it'll show you where that x value goes. So that would be at negative 11. Remember, this is move left 12, so it's going to go that direction. So it's moving to the left 12, so it would end up at negative 11. And then what was the negative 18? Was the y. Now, this that we just did, those of you that have trouble geometrically, you can use that on the graphs as well, which is the next thing we're going to look at. There is some paper and pencil practice in Module 3. I think it's the next to the last item. And since you'll definitely have a problem like that on the test, you might want to do the pencil and paper practice, at least some of it. Because doing it online is not the same thing as drawing it yourself, okay? And this is where I told you guys, remind me to bring up the homework so we can talk about how you do those graphs. But we're going to do this like pencil and paper. So we're going to take this graph. That's f of x. And we are going to draw f of x minus 1. Now, some students have a really hard time geometrically. If you guys have children, or if you're going to have children one day, I tell you, let them do as much as you can with Legos and things like that. It develops the brain for the kinds of things that we're about to do here. Let them play Battleship, unless you're anti-war or something. I mean, they have to do that, right? In Battleship, you have to know where you are. Okay, so what's x minus 1? What does that do?
Shifts right.
Okay, that shifts right. Now, let's do this geometrically first, which what I'm talking about is I'm going to physically take the points and I'm going to move them to the left. But if you have trouble with that, what we can do is we can write down the points and we can shift each of the x's to the right one and then plot. That's another way you can handle it. So let's do it the easier way first, okay? I'm going to take this end point and I'm going to move it right. It's right there. Do you agree?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Take this vertex. Move it right one. Now, if I were drawing this thing, I would move any point that I want to. So I would probably move this here. That's the one you don't want to do online. It'll mess up your draft. Okay. Online, you only want to do end points and corner points. You don't want to do anything in between. It'll mess up the graph and you'll have to start over. Okay, so I just move that endpoint, I move this vertex or corner point, and I'm going to move this one to the right one, and then I'm going to move the 4, 0 to the right one. And the shape should be the same. If it gets stretched, that does make it distorted a little. Get stretched or shrunken, but otherwise it should look the same, to be the same piece. Now, just in case anybody has trouble with that, what we could do is we could write down the original points. So these are the points on f of x. So negative 4, 0, negative 2, negative 3, 2, 3, and 4, 0. Shifting right means you're adding 1. So you take negative 4 plus 1, negative 2 plus 1, plus 1, and 4 plus 1. That's shifting right when you add 1. So those points end up at negative 3, 0, negative 1, negative 3, and 3, 3, and 5, 0. So if you need to, you could do it that way. You can just, that's kind of like what we did on the last page. Mm-hmm. We took a point and we did those shifts. Okay, but if you're good geometrically, you can just move them. And then we have one more. No, we have a couple more. You ready? Mm-hmm. That's ready? Okay. We're going to draw the opposite of f of x. What is that saying to do? Left across where? Yes, reflect across the y, no, reflect across the x-axis. We're changing y. Here's the x-axis. Y is positive there and negative there. So we're reflecting across the x-axis. So if you're on the x-axis, you stay. This point, which is the point negative 2, negative 3,
we'll shift to the next
one. Yes, that's going to come up here.
Negative 2, 3.
Yeah, so it's at negative 2, positive 3. So you're negating the y. And remember, I'm not, even though I'd like to do 0, 0 online, you can't do it. So you can skip that one. This one is at 2, 3. So it would be at 2, negative 3. And then any of them, when you're shift, when you're reflecting across the x-axis and they're on the x-axis, they just stay where they are. So that's what that one looks like. All right, you guys ready to do the double? Do one that's got two changes. And because it's got two changes, so that students who are going to take a little bit longer to understand this, I'll do the points first, so they can see what where things are ending up.
So the endpoints don't move. It's just
They did it because they were on the x-axis. This was a reflection across the x-axis. Because remember, we're negating y. Y is zero there. So when you negate zero, you're still at zero. So that's why they didn't go anywhere. Ready? Mm-hmm. Next one? Okay. So, first you guys tell me what the changes are. First we... Okay. Reflect across the y-axis. And it is okay in this case to think you're going to negate your x. You are going to negate whatever your x is. And then what's the plus one do? No, it's actually what you think. It is up one because this is the y and then we're adding one. So we are going to go up one. So I'm going to write the original points here. Negative 4, 0, negative 2, negative 3, 2, 3, and 4, 0. And we'll show these changes, okay, one at a time. So we're going to do the reflection across y, which is negating x. So we would get 4, 0, 2, negative 3. Negative 2, 3, and negative 4, 0. So there's negating your x. And then we'll shift up 1, which means we're adding 1 to the y. So we're taking the point 4, 0. That would be 4, 0 plus 1, which is 4, 1. And the point 2, negative 3 plus 1 goes to 2, negative 2. Negative 2, 3 plus 1 goes to negative 2, 4. And negative 4, 0 plus 1 goes to negative 4, 1. So if you want to do it that way, then you just plot these points. On the other hand, if you're good with, okay, let's negate the x, we're over here, right? And then we go up 1. 4, 1. Okay, let's do that with this one. Negate the x, you're here, up 1. 2, negative 2. Okay? This one, negate the x, you're here, go up 1, that's the one that's at negative 2, 4. And then the last one, 4, 0, went here, and then up 1. Which point was that? Which point did that come from?
The second one.
The second one? Okay, so you want to follow this way or by the picture?
That way.
This way?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I negated the negative 2. That became 2, but the y didn't change yet. Right? And then I added 1 to the y. Negative 3 plus 1 gives me negative 2.
So
up 1 is adding 1 to y.
So that negative 2 went to a positive 2.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, right. Yes. The negatives work like you think they do. Okay? Anybody else on that one? All right, we got one more. This one is a little bit of a challenge. And this is the one I wanted to show y'all. You know how a little while ago you told me, oh, if we add 1 to x, we move left. If we subtract 1, we move right. Okay. Not if there's a reflection. That's why I gave you the trick. Okay, so you have to be really careful with this one. This is a reflection of the x, so or a negation of the x. So you can negate x, which is the same thing as reflecting across the y-axis. That's the negative in front of the x. But the next thing you need to think about is whether it's shifting to the right from there or to the left. And this is where I had said if you'll set it equal to 0 and solve, it's safer. Because we're going to add 2, but then we've got to divide by negative 1. So that's actually left 2. Yeah, that's confusing. That one's confusing. But the plus 3 isn't confusing. Okay. So we're going to do this first. Then we're going to go left. And then the third thing is we're going to go up. All right?
Yep.
So let's take a point. Let's take this one. Reflect across y. You're here. Everybody following?
Yeah.
We're going to go left 2. We're going to go up 3. 1, 2, 3. It actually went in that same spot. Do that with the next one. We're going to negate x. Come here. We're going to go left 2. We're going to go up 3.
Same spot.
Yeah.
When you go right, you just do negative 2.
No, that's what I'm saying. You can't count on that minus 2 if there's a reflection. Okay? That's why I wanted you to use this little equation to figure out which way it actually moves. So you do have to notice that you have the reflection for x. But then set that x expression equal to 0 and solve it, and it shows you whether it's left or right. It's the opposite of what you think when there's a reflection. Okay? All right, the third point was here, right? The one that was at 2, 3.
Mm-hmm.
Reflect. Go left.
Two.
Go up. I reflected it. I went left 2, then I went up 3. And let's do the last one. This was here. It came over here to negative 4.
Two
to the left. 1, 2, 3. There it is. That one's a challenge. I'll do this at home. Graph this in your calculator. And then graph the square root of negative x minus 2. Put your friend there. Add 3. And you're going to see what happens to it. Okay? You're going to see that it reflects, moves left, moves up. Yeah. No. You can just drop in during office hours. Unfortunately, I went and asked, and we have a division meeting that starts at 3:30 today, so I gotta go.
Okay.
I said, can I stay in my office for my students? No, you have to do the division meeting. So I'll be back in my office tomorrow.
Okay. Would it be possible to maybe schedule an appointment in the future?
You can, but the thing about appointments is, and this is nothing against students, stuff comes up, 9 times out of 10, the student doesn't show up, and I'm saving that appointment, so I just don't usually make it.
Okay.
It's just first come, first serve as you get there.
No problem. Thank you very much.
Sure.
See you Thursday.
All right.
Why would I do that?